mini conference meeting in Lithuri. I'm really glad to see you all, to see old friends, nice friends around here. And there's really not too much to say except to thank my fellow colleagues, Isabel and Matthew, for a great organization, for putting together a wonderful program for all of us. And to thank Norma, I don't know where Norma is, but of course you, most of you were in contact with Norma, and her work was really fundamental for putting together this program. And besides that, I'd like to thank the University of Yucatan for lending us this beautiful place to have another conference meeting for CIMAC Mérida. And last but not least, I would like to welcome and introduce to you Professor Vasis Leyov Futorny. Did I pronounce it right? No. He's Slava for friends. Slava is a great friend. He has been several times to Mexico, and he comes from the University of Sao Paulo in Brazil, and he will be lecturing on representation theory for infinite dimensional the algebras. Thank you very much. Thanks for being here.
The rooms where there are meetings. I mean, this is just fantastic. But the life is different in other places. So this is the meeting we had in Brazil. And this is Amazon River. Of course, when you get excited by the speaker, so this is Olivier Mathieu from France, explaining something. When you get excited, you don't feel piranhas biting you. So this is just to show you that there are different circumstances for the meetings. That's very wonderful. Thank you. And Well, one of these two guys is obviously me. So I wanted, again, inspired by a conversation with Bernardo at breakfast, I thought that I will ask him first of all, and then everyone else. Who do you think is the guy on the left?
That's Iran, right?
Who?
That is in Iran.
No, that's the second question, but first, who is the person?
Al Jaber?
Al Khwarizmi.
Al Khwarizmi.
Yeah. The one who wrote Al Jaber. Yeah, the founder of Al Jaber. Okay, so the second question is where this picture was taken. So one suggestion is Iran, which is quite natural because he was Pers. But it's not Iran.
The arches are Iranians.
Yeah, but it's not Iran. Okay, does anyone, Yashan should know that.
I'm not sure. Uzbekistan?
Yes, it's Uzbekistan. And why? Because there was Academy of Science many, many centuries ago. It was Academy of Science, and they brought in particular him and other famous people in those days, Avicenna, and many others. The Academy of Science did not last long because the ruler changed, and that was the end of financing, as we know, right, when the things changed. But for a short period of time, it was great. So why I'm showing that? Of course, inspired by Bernardo, but I mean, I'm asking advice from this person when we got stuck in one of the problems that I would be talking about. So they asked his advice, and he whispered to me, and we managed it. So, yeah, of course, I'm joking. Thank you. So we can start now. So it was it is a quite difficult task in three lectures to tell you about in this infinite subject. Especially, I had no idea what kind of audience I'm going to have. So I thought there will be students and specialists. So I will try to have something for everyone. So I will go from trivial stuff, basic stuff, to current research. And then I will go back and forth. And I hope I will sort of give you an idea about this vast area of mathematics today. So three lectures will be on different but related subjects, naturally. Today I will speak about one class of infinite dimensional algebras, and tomorrow the second class, and then next lecture is the last class. Of course, they're all interrelated, and so I will go back and forth all the time. So let's start. So today my main object will be a Lie algebra of vector fields, algebraic vector fields. So before defining these Lie algebras, let's go back to the origin of Lie theory, or how we justify the importance of Lie algebras. So suppose we have some associative algebra A. So I'm not specifying the field, so in general it doesn't matter, or if it matters, I will assume that we work with complex numbers. Okay, fixing an associative algebra, we can consider a set of linear maps. I have the linear operators on A, which satisfy the Leibniz rule. So these operators behave like the first derivative. So, of course, this is just, it's not just a set, because we can add these operators, which we call derivations. We can add them, and we can multiply them by the scalar, and then we have a linear structure on this set. It becomes a vector space. Well, whenever we have a vector space, we can, especially of operators, the natural question is whether we can compose them and get another operator of this space. Well, we know the answer that we cannot compose in a natural way two derivations, We know this from the calculus. You can take first derivative and you compose it with the first derivative, you get a second derivative, and second derivative does not satisfy the Leibniz rule. Right? If you twice derivate, you will get an extra terms, which we don't want in this formula. So the second derivative is not a derivation, and hence this space is not closed under the operation of composition of operators. Nevertheless, we can define a different multiplication if we do it like that. This is the usual composition, fg minus gf. Then you can check that this will be a derivation if f and g are two derivations. And this defines an algebra structure on this vector space. Well, it's not associative, because we changed the operation. And in fact, that the term A becomes a Lie algebra. And I will just remind for those who don't know, or just remind everyone of what Lie algebra is. So a first example, so suppose our A associative algebra is just Laurent polynomials with one variable, then it's a good exercise to compute what the derivations are of A, and you can show that this will be a vector space spanned by this derivative multiplied by the power of t, and these tn's will form a basis of this algebra. And then you can compute directly their bracket, and then they satisfy this nice formula. And so we multiply with the new multiplication on their A, which we call a Lie bracket. These two operators, we will get a multiple of D with the index by a sum. And this we will call, and it is called the first Lie algebra, and we'll denote it by W1. Okay, so as I mentioned, we introduce a Lie algebra structure on this space of derivations of an associative algebra. And what is a Lie algebra over some field K? So this is a vector space. Naturally, it's the first thing we want. We want a linear structure on our G. And then there is a bilinear map, G cross G to G, so which defines the product or algebra structure on our space, which satisfies two axioms. So we don't have associativity anymore. Instead, we have anticommutativity, so which says that the square of any element is zero. And we have a substitute for associativity, which is called the Jacobian identity, and which is sort of a triple identity. And you can easily remember it, because when x is, you take a product with the product of y, and z, this is the same as differentiating, like the derivative rule. Right? You first take, this is just a cycle, so three cycles, you rotate them, and you get a sum. But you can also rewrite it in terms of derivative rule. I remember when I was a student, still, and when the first time I saw this definition, I said, well, the square of the element is zero. This must be a very trivial object. What's the point of studying these things? And then I saw this example. I remember even now when I saw this example, I said, wow. So if we start with any associative algebra, we can produce the Lie algebra just by changing the operation the way we did in the example above. Right, so we have an associative algebra with some operation, and we now define a different operation, a different product, as AB. This is AB, it's an odd product, minus BA. And again, one can easily check that this will define a Lie algebra structure on A, so the new product satisfies these two axioms. So meaning, every associative algebra produces a Lie algebra. So it shows that the world of Lie algebras is quite rich. And then I was convinced that maybe I should look into this and study a Lie theory. And it was a very wise choice in those days. So here's a couple more examples, classical examples how Lie structures, Lie algebra structures appear naturally. Suppose now we have a Lie algebra G in finite dimension, so fix a basis G1, Gn. Then we can construct a symmetric algebra. So, well, symmetric algebra we can construct for any vector space just by taking a tensor algebra first, so summing the tensor powers of this vector space, and then the tensor product defines an associative structure, associative algebra structure on this sum of all possible tensor powers of vector space, and then we modulo ideal to get the symmetric algebra. We want the ideal generated by x tensor y minus of y tensor x, all possible x and y. And then we get associative commutative algebra for any vector space. In particular, I want to do it for our Lie algebra, G. That is just a polynomial algebra. In variables, you can think of G1, Gn as variables. They commute in this synthetic algebra. And now I define a new operation, which is called boson bracket. So it's done step by step. First, I define it for the basis elements of point elements of G. So this new bracket I define as a Lie bracket in G. This was a Lie algebra, so there is a multiplication, a Lie bracket there, and we define it the way it was. And then if you want to take polynomials in A's, in B's, and you want to define a boson bracket between them, so you use the product rule. So first you do it one element with a product of two, and then you extend same way. So what comes out is a Lie algebra structure, which is called Lie boson algebra. And another example, I don't know why this dollar sign it here. So suppose we have a 2n-dimensional space with a symplectic form, and we choose coordinates xi's and y's, and then we consider a space of smooth functions on this space. Then the boson bracket can be defined this way, and it defines a Lie algebra structure here. So there's another natural example. So there are many, many others coming from any area of mathematics. Okay, so we already saw example of the first Weyl algebra, W1, right? As a derivation of Laurent polynomials in one variable. Well, this is algebraic definition of this algebra, right? When we look at derivation of some associative algebra. Well, there is a sort of geometric version of that. So if we look at the circle S1 and we consider the Lie algebra of the algebraic vector fields in the circle, so just working with Fourier polynomials, and so this would take a span of complex, in this case complex span of these operators, and then you can check again directly that they satisfy this formula for the Lie bracket, and which establishes isomorphism between the Lie algebra vector fields on the circle with the derivation algebra of Laurent polynomials in one variable. So it's sort of a marriage of algebra and geometry happening here. The more famous algebra is not the first Lie algebra itself, but Virasoro algebra, which is the universal central extension of the Lie algebra. And the universal central extension happens to be one dimensional in this case, so which means non-trivially, the way that it doesn't split into a direct sum of Lie algebras, we can only get add the one-dimensional center here. And then the cocycle appears, the formula changes this way. Right, so this is the old part, and then we get a scalar multiple of C. So this is the classical object, and probably everyone heard it many, many times because Virasoro Rajendra was extremely famous. Well, it still is, but especially maybe the last 20 years of the 20th century, that was number one object in theoretical physics. And very important in mathematics as well. But this is sort of the dimension one when we deal with the circle. The question is how to generalize it to a higher dimension. So circle we can generalize in two different ways, to a sphere or to the torus. And so what is the right direction to go? Well, you know, if you go to Tim Hortons in the US, there are two types of donuts. One is like almost like a sphere, right? There's no hole, and one is a torus with a hole. Well, I like the first one better, right? But I mean, it's a matter of taste. But here, which one is better? Well, from an algebraic point of view, it's not clear. If you tell me, so this is a Lie algebra of vector fields, to me it would not be clear which one to choose. And maybe for geometers, that was easy decision. And torus was the right choice to go. And which is clear from an algebraic point of view, if you remember that remember this isomorphism, that the vector fields is the same as the derivation algebra, in this case, for Laurent polynomials in one variable. So, Laurent polynomials indicate that you should go to torus, because the vector fields on the torus will be a derivation algebra of Laurent polynomials in many variables. And naturally, if you want to generalize derivation algebra of Laurent polynomials, one variable, you should go to multiple variables. So let's explain why torus is more natural. I will come back to the discussion of a sphere a bit later. Now, but we go to the torus, we choose torus. Okay, so the algebra that comes out, if you look at this vector fields on an n-dimensional torus, which is the same way identified now with the derivation algebra of Laurent polynomials in n variables. So that's what we know by Wn, and it's called the n-primit algebra. And it has a natural subalgebra. So Laurent polynomials, so you remember how derivations look like in one variable and in similar in n variables. So this will be just, in this case, partial derivatives times the Laurent polynomial. And then span of this is our derivation algebra. But now imagine that as a coefficient, I will take not a Laurent polynomial, but just a polynomial in n variables. They form a subalgebra. So when you take a Lie bracket, of course you will not create negative powers of t. So we denote the derivations of polynomials by Wn plus, and this is a Lie subalgebra, which we call polynomial, not Laurent polynomial, vector fields.
It's sort of like considering the holomorphic vector fields in some sense?
Algebraic vector fields, the right word, or polynomial vector fields. Because you allow coefficients which are polynomials only. And you don't allow other functions. And so you can say that the polynomial vector fields on an affine space. So this algebra, this Wn plus, is famous. Sometimes the plus is dropped, classically, and it is denoted Wn. But since we will be working with the Laurent polynomials further on, I prefer to change the notation, so I keep this. And this is a classical Cartan type Lie algebra, one of four series. So there are four series of infinite dimensional Lie algebras which are called Cartan type. Because Cartan studied them, he continued the work of Sophus Lie and completed, you can say completed his work in a series of three or four papers around those years, and then he described these four types of infinite dimensional algebras. So this is the Witt algebra, polynomial vector fields, this is special, Hamiltonian and contact. I will not define those three series because I will not be talking about them. But these are four famous series of infinite dimensional algebras. Now, well, so you see this was the beginning of the 20th century. And there was a big gap before these algebras were brought back to life in the 20th century. And mostly thanks to Victor Katz and other people that I will mention now. So there was in the 60s, 1960s, 50s and 60s, there was an interest in study of graded Lie algebras. So there were many contributions from Steinberg, Ulemin, and many others. And then in 1967, there was a work by Weisvetter, who rigorously studied Lie algebras and obtained so the first classification results. But it was not complete. But Victor Katz used that work of Weisvetter. They were close friends in those days. And he used his ideas and completed the classification. And this is a famous theorem of Victor Katz from 68. So the idea is to look at the Z-graded Lie algebras. So which is a vector space, it's a direct sum of the components indexed by integers, components of Li's. Of course, there are too many, unless you make some restrictions, there will be too many of them. So we make a restriction about the growth. And the growth means that the dimensions of these components, the graded components, are bounded by the value of some polynomial. So this is called finite growth. And then the question is, can we classify all simple Lie algebras, simple and without ideals, or finite growth? And the theorem of Victor Katz was the following. So he gave a classification with some restriction. And his restriction was that the minus one components, 0 and 1, should generate the algebra. And also, well, naturally, if you look at L minus 1, and if you take a bracket with L 0, you will end up in L minus 1, right? Because of the grade. Li bracket with Lj, the result is an Li plus j. So L minus 1 is a module over L 0. And then the requirement is that it should be a simple module. And under these two technical conditions, he showed that any such simple Lie algebra belongs to one of three classes. Well, first is a simple finite dimensional complex Lie algebra, which were already well known in those days. The classification, which started in the 19th century by Killing, was completed by Cartan in the 1914, right? So this was well known long ago. And then the second class is affine Kazimuthi algebra. Of course, Katz did not call it affine Kazimuthi algebra, right? The name was given later, and this will be my main object of discussion tomorrow. So for now, we will just think of this in the following way. So we take algebra of the first class, let's call it G, simple finite dimensional over complex numbers. And then, for now, it's not absolutely correct. but let's picture it like that.
So with tensor, in fact, I can take any algebra G, not necessarily simple finite dimensional, any Lie algebra. And I can tensor with Laurent polynomials in one variable. So this is called affinization of G. G can be finite or infinite dimensional, doesn't matter. And this will have a structure of a Lie algebra. Let's call it G hat. And how we define a bracket? Well, naturally, the bracket can be defined this way. As a bracket in G, and then tensor P to the n plus n power. Then one can easily check that the axioms are satisfied over the bracket because they're satisfied here. So for now, we assume that this is our fine custom algebra. So you can visualize it this way. And then we will be more precise. And then the third class is Cartan type algebra. Those are one of those four types. Well, of course, it was sort of, well, perhaps since I mentioned Weisfeller, probably you know the story. So it was a tragic story. Weisfeller immigrated to the United States, and he was a great traveler, like Bernardo. He liked to travel, and he traveled in Chile, in South America. And in Chile, he disappeared. And well, Victor Kaltz told me, I did not know the story, but he told me that for many years, after Victor Kaltz moved to the United States, he tried to find what happened. And he hired a private detective for whom many years was trying to find the traces. And finally, it was, the investigation was completed. And it turned out that, well, he met some guerrillas in the mountains in Andes, in Chile, and probably was killed by them. And then, well, American investigation was completed, and the Chilean government did not want to look into that. There was even a petition, like a year ago, these petitions were signing a petition asking to continue, for Chilean government to continue and actually to find those or to name those who did that. So unfortunately, my spirit died very young. But nevertheless, Victor Kaltz completed his work. But this was still, you know, this was subject to these two technical conditions. And then he conjectured what should be the classification if we draw those two conditions. And this conjecture was proven by Olivier Mathieu. The one that I showed you on the picture, he was talking about something else on that picture. But nevertheless, in 1992, he completed the classification without technical restriction. And then it turns out that you don't get much more than you already had in the CAT theory. So besides the simple finite dimensional Lie algebras, a fine cosmic algebras and Cartan type algebras, you only add centerless Virasoro algebra. And so what's important to us is that we have two classes of infinite dimensional algebras that appear here. Cartan type, with WN more general, and Kasmudi algebras. So these are two classes which we will discuss, or their representations we will discuss today and tomorrow. Just one remark. What would happen if instead of torus we choose sphere as a generalization of the circle? Well, it turns out that well, geometrically it's not as nice, but algebraically it's still a very nice object. So how to define the Lie algebra of vector fields on a sphere or in any algebraic variety? So you look at the functions. the algebra of functions on that variety, you may restrict what kind of functions you want to consider, and then you take, this will be associative algebra, and then you consider the algebra of derivations. And that's how it's done in general. So you can start with an arbitrary F1 variety. So X inside of the F1 space. So we can assume it is irreducible. Probably from algebraic point of view, the first question naturally is whether the Lie algebra of derivations or vector fields, which we will call vector fields or algebraic vector fields on X, is simple as a Lie algebra. Well, we know it did not appear in the classification of Katz Matthew because it's not graded of finite growth. But nevertheless, it can be simple and a nice Lie algebra, infinite dimensional one. Well, it turns out that if we look at the functions, which are polynomial on this X, what does it mean? It means that the functions will be the quotient of a polynomial ring by the ideal defined by this variety. Right, so the variety is a fine variety determined by the system of polynomials, or sequence of polynomials. So if we take a polynomial ring and a polynomial algebra and a quotient, the ideal generated by those polynomials, this is the algebra of functions on the variety that we consider. And derivations of this algebra will be our Lie algebra of vector fields on this variety. And then turns out that it is simple, even only if the variety is smooth. Well, we will look into this question with my Canadian colleague, Yuri Billy. And we thought this is not known at all. And we searched in literature, we talked to geometers, differential geometers, no answer. Then we proved it. And after we proved it, of course, we discovered that this was known. It was known already. So in fact, it goes back to David Jordan's study of the derivations algebras. He never called this vector fields on the variety. For him, it was just a derivation algebra. And he proved, not if and only if, he proved one direction. I don't remember which one. Probably that if it's a smooth, then it is simple. And then we were half happy. Now we thought, okay, now we completed the criteria for the simplicity of the derivation algebra. Wrong. So soon we discovered that the other way was also shown by Sievert. And so this was end of 20th century, beginning of the 21st century. So this was all set. So how to define the singular points? So what are the regular points? So singular and non-regular, if you give me a point and I want on the variety and you want to check whether it is singular or not, so you look at the rank of the Jacobian matrix. You do partial derivatives of the defining polynomials for this variety. And when you substitute the rank, there is a maximal value, there is the rank of this matrix, or the maximal rank of this matrix when you plug in a point. So if point gives the maximum rank, that's a regular point. If it's a smaller, then it's a singular point. So it's a very clear.
Can you use this box to find some resolution of singularities for varieties? I mean, just looking at the algebra.
No, nobody did that. I mean, this was only algebraic approach from all people. I'm not sure how to what can you gain?
Well, that's a question.
No. I mean, it had not been done, we have not thought about that.
Yeah, maybe you follow up with that question. If you have a resolution of singularity, will that give you a penetration of linear algebras and you no longer see the problem?
Yeah, I'm sure it will give you penetration, yes. Well, the singularities, in the case of singularities, in the question about singularities, actually the people looked at, there was a different, completely different study before this criteria was established. So naturally, from the beginning, the people that were interested in this knew that singularity must be involved somehow, and probably this conjecture was from the beginning, though it was never formulated until the results of Jordan. Yes, and so there was some activity, definitely, not related to these people. Yeah, and I'm sure there, it defines indeed the application. Yeah, this was more geometric study than algebra. For Jordan and for us, the motivation was to get a new class of simple infinite dimensional algebras. That was our goal, so generalizing the WN algebra, doing algebras. Yeah, so I'm going to tell you a little bit more. So first I want to tell you about the representations of the DeWitt algebras, and then tomorrow compare with the general situation, which is almost nothing is known in the general setup of arbitrary algebra. So my goal now is to tell you about the representations of the DeWitt algebras. This is the most studied case. Even so, the classical situation is W1. So the representations that naturally appear and that are of interest are those which are called weight representations. So we say that the representation or module of W1 is weight if this operator, so this derivation is diagonalizable on this vector space. So, this we just require that this operator acts diagonally on a vector space, on a module V. In this case, we say that module is weight. And there was a problem, old problem, to classify all simple weight modules for W1. Well, this problem was solved in 92 by Olivier Mathieu and other French mathematicians, Martin Piard, and it's funny that there are two French groups and they didn't know about each other work until both proved. Very interesting. And the classification is quite simple. So if we look at Laurent polynomials here, so naturally the scalars form a submodule, right? Because when we apply elements of the algebra, they are derivations, they involve derivative. Derivative will kill the scalar. So this becomes a submodule. So when we eliminate that, we will get a simple module of a W1. So this is sort of a natural example to see. You may think, okay, why not? How come polynomials, real polynomials, PT, do not form a subalgebra? Because when you differentiate, you stay within the polynomials. You don't get negative powers. But remember that we allow the coefficients to be Laurent polynomials. So there are negative powers. We not only differentiate, but we also multiply by any power of T. And of course, we will get all our ongoing loans. Well, there is another class like they call highest or lowest weight modules. Well, you probably heard it, or there's a natural concept for such models. You look at operators, the ends with n greater than zero, and you define that there is a vector which is annihilated by all these polynomials, the n with positive n. This will give you a highest weight model. If we do the opposite, the n annihilates when n is negative, that this will be a lowest weight model. So there is an initial construction. So these models, I don't want to say more about them. And there was an interesting family, Kaplansky's and Dorobein models. There was a different name in differential geometry. They're called modules of tensor fields. And there is a more common name now, intermediate modules. So this is the family, two-parameter family. So we fix two complex numbers, alpha and beta, and you will look at the vector space T spanned by the elements Bx, right, where S, so the index here is not necessarily an integer, right? It's a shift by beta of integers. So beta can be any complex number. So you look at the span. And now we define a module structure on this vector space over our algebra W1. So we just need to say how decays act. And they can act like that. So if we apply it to BS, we get a shift by the index of T. And there is a coefficient appear here which depends on S, alpha, and K. So these modules are almost always simple modules. So only in exceptional cases they are not simple. So they will be submodules. So when alpha is 0 and 1 and beta is integer. In this case we can assume that because beta is shifted by integer, so we can assume that it is 0. And then we just need to consider T0, 0 and T1, 0. And their structure is also simple. This is just a length 2 module. So in T0, 0, there is a submodule, which is one-dimensional. And then the quotient, no, it's not length 2. Right, so the quotient will be in T0, 1, and T0, 1, quotient by that is C. Right, so it's a very simple structure, and in fact it comes from the Ram complex, which will appear now. Right, so this classification was done, and then the question was, how can we generalize that to Wn? This is W1. 92, the result is known. And I remember there was a big paper by some Chinese mathematician who wrote the beginning of 2000 that very little is known about representations of Wn except the case of W1. And the reason is because it becomes too complicated and there are no techniques developed, etc., etc. So there's no hope. Well, one should never give up hope, and we will see that we managed to do that. So, again, so I will denote, just for convenience, I change to capital N. So these are derivations of Laurent polynomials in N variables. A is my algebra of functions. So this is the ring of Laurent polynomials. And this D's, now you see that the same P appear here in the partial derivative. And so these are free generators of our Lie algebra considered as an A module. So we allow multiplication by algebra, by functions, by Laurent polynomials. So we can view it as a name model this way. And the Lie bracket can be described very easily using the multi-indices. So now I have this DA, DB, so A and B are fixed, but R and M are multi-indices. Yeah, you like that. So R and M are n tuples of integers. And then the Lie bracket is when you first you apply DA here, so you pick up MA's component of M, and then you subtract the other way around. So DB you apply to DR, and then you pick up RB. And then naturally what comes? It's clear what we should get. So this is the Lie bracket. The span of these operators, D's, right, D1 up to Dn, this is an analog of the Cartan's algebra in WM. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
yeah,
so the
NAs
and the
RBs
are
they're these guys. So put here A. It's DA partial derivative with respect to A. So A is a number, it's just a number, not a double.
The
M is a multi-index, similar to TR. M is a tuple, MA is the eighth number in that tuple, and MB is the distance. Right, so the point is that there is an analog of a Cartan's algebra, like usually in the Lie, obviously finite dimensional, simple algebras. And that makes everything work in this case. Contrary to the case of an arbitrary affine variety X, when we look at the ones that we discussed above, when we look at the derivations, the algebra of derivations or vector fields on this variety, there is no analog of the Cartan's algebra in general. And that makes a big difference. Okay, and then so we describe the category of representations we want to study. So we are interested in weight models, those that have this decomposition into the subspaces labeled by the tuples of complex numbers. And these complex numbers are eigenvalues of the corresponding D's. So you remember that in the W1 case, we require the D is diagonalizable. Now we have several D's, and we want them to be simultaneously diagonalizable on our representation. And this is kind of representation we want to study. And then the problem is, can we classify simple models, in this category of weight models, assuming that n lambdas are finite? If you don't assume that they are finite dimensional of these lambdas, we cannot say much. And so to put the restriction that lambdas are finite dimensional. Okay? And then we try to mimic the situation in the case of W1, in the classification of Mathieu. Remember that the third class of models, which is the largest class of representation, was the one which are called intermediate series or tensor fields models. So naturally we should try to define analog of those. And in fact they were known from differential geometry. They were known. And so the algebraic construction is the following. You take any finite dimensional GLM model, so call it W, and then the alpha will be a scalar with which the central element of GLM, the scalar, the identity matrix. And you take a tuple of gammas, complex gammas, and you define the tensor model as a tensor product of two vector spaces. So our W, this is finite dimensional, and Laurent polynomials in n variables. So this becomes infinite dimensional vector space. And we also use this complex tuple gamma for shift. So we allow complex powers of variables. And then the action is the following. So of course we just need to define how these basis elements act. So this derivation, R is the multi-indexed again. So this is T1, R1, T2, R2, and so on. And when you apply to a typical element of this vector space, you get the following. So this term is obvious. Of course, when you apply TA, it should differentiate Q and pick up the mu A's component. But the interesting part is that we get this sum here, which involves the action of GLN. So this is the matrix unit of GLN acting on the element of W, and remember that W was a GLN model. So here is the GLN structure which is used on W. And then one can check that you get a model structure on this space of the Lie algebra, or WN algebra. And remember that in the case of W1, there were very few exceptional cases, for alpha 0 or 1 and beta 0 could be the integer, when the model was not simple. A similar thing happens here, that generically the model that we just defined above was is simple, except few cases, and these cases are described by the Durand complex like that. So these are zero forms, one forms, n forms, and it's a shifted again, the Durand complex shifted by Q1 gamma 1, Q2 gamma 2, and so on. So again, this is multi-index. So the models that appear here, so if you ask what are the corresponding tensor models, I mean, these are models of differential forms, but in the terms that we define, what are they? So they're here. So this is the tensor model that we define here, and we just need to solve what is W in this case. W is the case exterior power of an natural n-dimensional representation of GLN. And so the middle terms here that appear here, they are still simple. But these guys, the extreme ones, are not simple if gamma is a tuple of integers. Right, so it's very similar to W1. And now it explains why in W1 those were exceptional cases. So this is very clear, and this was known. It goes back to the results of Rudakov. This is from the 70s, and Ashwara Rao from India, 90s. So this was well known. Okay, so remember that our goal was to classify simple cuspidal models whose dimensions are dimensions or the multiplicities of those weight spaces are finite. But let's make a stronger restriction. So we ask, can we classify those models, weight models, whose weight multiplicities are bounded by some monster? Because they can be finite dimensional but growing linearly to and not bounded. Well, let's put restrictions that they are bounded. Can we classify simple cuspidal models? It turned out that this is the essential problem. If we can solve this problem, we can solve the classification problem. Okay, so before discussing cuspidal models, let's ask what will be, remember the second class in matrix classification was highest, lowest weight models. So we should have analogs of these here for WN. And now I describe them. So remember that we have a Zn grading by the Cartan subalgebra D1 Dn, spent by D1 Dn on our algebra. But now I will look. Only I will forget about D1, Dn minus 1. I will just look at one operator, Dn. And this will define a z-grade on our algebra. So I just look at the action of this fellow here. And it, is a joint action of the Lie algebra WN defines this decomposition. So here it has positive eigenvalues, zero eigenvalue, and negative eigenvalues. The zero component looks like that. It's a semi-direct product of the derivation algebra of vector fields on n minus one dimensional curves. And here is just an abelian ideal when you have functions around polynomials in n minus one variable, and then Tn is this designated derivation. And now we can play the usual game in representation theory. Whenever we have such triangular decomposition of a Lie algebra, we can take a module over here. We can define the plus part x trivially, and we can induce. And so that's what we do, and what comes out is so-called generalized Verma module. So this is induced module, so we take a tensor product of the enveloping algebra of WN, tensor with this x tilde, over the enveloping algebra of this part. And as a vector space, this will just look like that. So enveloping algebra of the negative part here, tensor our model. And the nice thing about these induced models, that they have a unique maximal submodel. When we take a quotient, we will get a unique reducible, a unique simple quotient of Mx. So the induced modules are nice because they are sort of universal modules, but on the other hand, they are always too big. They're very big, so multiplicities will not be bounded and will not be finite. But the hope is that when we take a maximal submodule and we kill it, taking a quotient, then we might get finite dimensional multiplicities. And that happens quite often. So in particular, we can play this game by choosing a right module to begin with. So we will induce from a tensor module T, where we choose this finite dimensional GLN. Remember, the zero part contained is a semi-direct product of vector fields in dimension one less and something else, some abelian idea. So we define a simple module over that. We choose a module over vector fields on the torus of dimension one less, then we extend to the abelian part, and then we induce. So we start with a tensor module, that's for n minus one dimension, and then we fix, we choose a scalar gamma, which will determine how that abelian ideal acts. And the action is just by multiplication by gamma. Remember these elements of the abelian ideal all at Tn, and then any function in n minus one. And that gamma is determined. And then it turns out that if we induce from this fellow and take a quotient, we'll get a finite dimensional weight space. So this standard, there are two tools in representation theory, standard ones. Induction, so inducing, and restriction. So they define two functors, which are extremely useful, and in many cases they provide what we need. So in this particular case, so taking an induced module and motion in the maximal submodule, we get a nice model. And these are analogs of highest weight models in matrix classification. Well, it turns out that one can do a little bit more because there is an action of the group GLN Z, and you can twist this model slightly, and we still get something of the same kind. So we call them highest weight type models. But it's a family, again, analogous to the family of highest weight models in Mathieu's classification. So it was a second class. So we define already tensor models, and we define our tensor fields models, and we define models of highest weight type. So we sort of cover W1. There is nothing in the W1 case which is not one of these representations. Of course, the hope was, the conjecture was, that probably that's it. We cannot have anything else. On the other hand, WN is quite a big algebra, and who knows how one can construct models, why there is no other types of models. For example, you can ask, why did we do it from n minus 1? Why could not I start with vector fields on the n minus 2 dimensional torus, take a simple model over that and induce up, and then take a quotient? How do I know that I will get the same as I get here? Well, the point is that if you do it, you can do it. You will get some simple model and probably different from these ones, but they will not have finite multiplicities. And remember, our restriction is that we will look at the weight modules with finite dimensional weight spaces. So there are many tricks we can apply to construct other simple models, but they will be outside of our category. So the people tried, natural things were tried, nothing came out, and then was a natural conjecture that probably that's it. But how can you prove? Well, we proved in 2016. So it was a long, from 92 to 16, 24 years.
Same 24 years.
But since your last time in America.
Yeah, so 1 year less. And so we proved that, in fact, the conjecture was correct. The conjecture was formulated by Rao, the Indian mathematician, who said that it should be like that. And then, indeed, so we see that there are essentially tensor modules, there are the highest weight modules, there is a finite dimensional module that is scalar functions, of course, or trivial simple module. And there are the simple submodels of oceans coming from the Durham complex. And that's it. There is nothing else. And so these are analogs of the one, remember the Laurent polynomials modulo C, modulo scalar functions in Matthew specification. Those two come from the Durham complex. Here we have a longer Durham complex, and there will be other models, and here we have models of differential forms. So, and these are simple cuspidal modules, so with bounded multiplicities. So they are only one-dimensional from their own complex or tensor modules. The highest weight type modules do not have bounded multiplicities, but they are finite still. So there were many preliminary results. So I mentioned here that so the Wanderjung and Zhao proved that the model at the cuspidal was bounded multiplicities or highest weight type. And highest weight type we explicitly constructed by taking a induced module, taking a quotient, and then twisting by elements of GLM C. But the cuspidal ones, so this is the tricky part, they were not known. And the success of this result is exactly in the classifying of cuspidal models. And the story of this classification is quite interesting. You know, when you go to Canada in winter, there is, unless you are skiing, a big fan of skiing or skating, there is not much to do. It's minus 30 outside. And so I was in Ottawa with him, with Yuri Bilik, and I mean, in Ottawa you cannot even ski. And so there was nothing to do, and he doesn't drink. So we were in the office working. And I remember that we got two interesting ideas how should we proceed. Well, one idea was that instead of just W and such, so we want to classify motors. What kind? Cusped. Meaning that the weight multiplicity should be bounded. Bounded, then you think, okay, what are the known classes of bounded motors? Except the trivial ones coming from the Durand complex. The only known serious classes were tensor field models. And tensor field models, remember how they construct. You take a finite dimensional model of GLN and tensor some huge algebra of Laurent polynomials. Laurent polynomials have a nice feature. If you do tensor with them, they'll all dimensions of the resulting model, the weight dimensions, will be the same. Because T is inverted. You can go back and forth. And these dimensions will be equal to the dimension of W you start with. So if you take two-dimensional model over k-dimensional model over GLN, and you tensor with Lorentz, you will get a model with all weight multiplicities equals k. So it's a homogeneous dimension. So it's a cuspid, the whole dimensions are bounded by k. But moreover, they're all equal to k. And, well, it says that in this case, we have the action of the algebra of functions, which is in this case, Laurent polynomials, on the model. So it's not only a model over the WN algebra, vector fields, but also a model over the algebra of functions. So it has a double feature. But algebra of functions is not part of our algebra. We must have always derivative involved. Right? So these tensor field models appear as models over the algebra of vector fields and also over the algebra of functions, which are around polynomials. So we will, well, then we thought, okay, maybe we should just restrict ourselves to this class of models. Let's see what we get. So we say that the module is a WN module, if it is both module for WN and for A. And there is a compatibility condition, which is here. Okay, and then and I said in this case, all weight multiplicity are the same, because T is inverted. And then we discovered that Rao already proved that all simple modules are precisely modules of tensor fields. There are no others. Well, maybe this is a very strong restriction, right? If you say that all that you have strict action of the algebra of functions beside the of your Lie algebra, maybe it's too strong and we limit ourselves too much. And we're losing lots of models. In fact, it was not the case. And I always the old generation probably remembers the movie Pretty Woman. To show that all that's in the picture. Remember? So you remember the scene when they were watching the polo game on horses, playing polo. And at some point, there's an interval and people are invited to come on the field and dump the holes that horses made. And the rich people come and start walking around to make it even. And that's exactly what we needed to do. Right? So if you look at this fellow, how does it look like? So we had one, this is basis t, t squared, and so on, and here we have t minus 1, t minus 2. And it goes like that. And then when we kill c, we kill this point. So the picture, this is the weight structure. It goes like that, then there is a hole, and then it goes. Oops. Then so what we need to do is to come here and to dump this hole. Now this is not a W1 model, because the algebra functions does not act here. not invertible anymore in the equation. But what we need to fix that. Okay. So, the idea was the following. So suppose we have a simple WN model, which we don't know what it is. Maybe we can construct a simple A WN model, which covers it. And if we can succeed, then we know, not even simple, any AWN model, but classical ones. And if we can do that, we can use it, since we know classification of simple AWN models, so we can hope that this fellow will be also simple as an AWN model, and because this is a homomorphism as WN models, not as AWN models. And then we can approach classification of classical models here by classical models here in AWN. And the classification is known there. Maybe this can give us exhaustion of our classification, that there is nothing else besides the tensor models. Okay, how can you construct something, a covering of your model? Typical is, again, inducing, right? That's how we do the universal module, and we take the maximum set module, and we cover the simple one. Well, we tried, it did not work. But severe weather in Canada helped to understand that we need to do not the induced one, but co-induced one. So instead of tensor product, we need to work with ohm. Well, this is a nice WN model, so here's explicit structure, and it's also a model over the functions. Here's explicit structure. So it's a nice AWN model. But it's, remember what you want. You want to not just any AWN models, you want a cuspidal one, the one whose weight multiplicity is abound. This fellow is not the one. It's too big. Well, then it took some time to figure that, in fact, one can choose a certain submodel inside that does the job. So inside of this big model, one can choose. I don't like, the technical part is not essential here. And the fact is that one can choose. After hard work, one can figure how to do it. And then, in fact, so we wrote this theorem that if you start with a cuspidal model for WN, then this particular model N hat will be a cuspidal one, and it will be a cover of our model. And that allows to complete the classification. There was an interesting, how to prove that it is cuspidal. That was the most tricky part, most difficult part. You know, to make conjectures, make guesses, is not that hard. You can correct them if necessary, but then to prove, in fact, that's the tough part. So, we made use of the following interesting operators, the elements of the enveloping algebra. So that they are labeled by, they have three integers labeling them. Labeling these operators. So if you take a zero part, upper part, so this is just a product of two elements. So I'm in W1 case. So it's EK, so is the same as DC. Remember the basis was, I changed notation from E to T, but that's the same thing. DK times dx. And then we build these operators recursively. So this is recursion relation. So we get a family of the operators, right, which are just, you can think of them as m's difference derivative. Well, then with some work, combinatorial work, you can figure that they look like that in general. So we could just define them this way, directly, but they constructed combinatorially. So, for example, if you take omega 1 minus 1 and 2, then the corresponding expression will be like that. And we recognize immediately that this is just a Casimir element of SL2 spent by E minus 1 is 0 and 1. So these three elements, E minus 1 is 0 and 1, they generate SL2. And this one, just a Casimir element, which is a generator of the center of the enveloping algebra of SL2. Right, so very nice operators. Okay, what we realized quickly that we need, so we will use these operators to show, so we want to show that the multiplicity is abundant, the dimensions of the vector space is abundant. To do that, one can construct sufficiently many elements of the enveloping algebra which annihilate this vector space, given weight vector space, and this will imply that it is bound. And so we were hoping that these operators will do the job, the omega operators. But for that we needed to find some closed form for the multiplication of these operators. Because how to show that in infinitely many of them x is 0. And we are trying to compose them, and it didn't work. Then we, okay, so the direct composition doesn't work. Maybe if we do Lie product, one omega times another omega minus in the opposite direction, maybe we get a close form, really close relation between the omegas this way. So we tried with computer, didn't work. And now it's, well, you remember a good part to be in winter in Canada, but also there's a good part to be in Brazil in summer. Well, you don't go outside. It, either it's raining or it's hot. So we were sitting at the university, working, and then we went to get a coffee. And we were stuck, really, we were hoping this would work, it didn't work, and there's no way. And suddenly, a friend of ours, Ivan Shesterkov, comes to the coffee room. And he is the big guru in Jordan algebra. And somehow, having coffee with him, gave us the idea, maybe the Lie bracket is not the right one. Maybe what we need is a Jordan bracket. So just change AB minus BA to AB plus BA. And this is the Jordan, this bracket is a Jordan bracket. This is AB plus BA. So it turns out that there is this complicated relation between these omega operators, which allows to go from quadratic part to linear part. And then playing with this, the boundness of multiplicities comes. So what we showed that, so if you fix any L, you will always find an integer M such that for all K and S, this operator annihilate every cuspidal W1 module, not so simple, but with the composition length L. So if you take some indecomposable, so if all those decomposable is not interesting, you reduce everything to simple ones, and it's done. But imagine that you have extensions of simple W1 models of intermediate series. And remember, intermediate series means all dimensions are one. But you can take extension of arbitrary dimension. And so suppose you have L copies, not even copies, L different tensor models which make an extension. We need to show how to annihilate them by sufficiently many of the sonic operators. And that's the result that helped. So eventually So we prove that from here it follows that the constructed M hat model, this AWN model, will be hospital, so the dimensions are bound. Since it is a cover of a given hospital WN model, so then all hospital come from AWN hospitals, which are known, and this contains a classification. And then this was all. And this was like a Pandora box. So immediately people, so it sort of gave a hope that you can apply similar techniques in other cases, for example, studying other carton type algebras, SN, AN, Hamiltonian, and there's a lot of work that's going on right now in different directions. So this was generalized to other classes of algebras. So I should stop my. So I will stop what I was planning to tell you a bit more. So I will do it tomorrow. Tell you about the structure of highest weight type models a little bit more. Because we just said they are highest weight type models. So you do tensoring from vector fields over a torus dimension one less, and then you take out the maximum model, you get a simple model. But what exactly do we get? So there was also it's quite interesting topic because it's related to vertex algebras and things like that. So maybe I will spend some time, a little bit of time tomorrow, just to finish this part. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions? Yes.
Yes, I have a question. I feel I should probably know the answer to. But these Cartan, of course, the Kac-Moody algebras, you can integrate them in groups. And can you do this with the Cartan type algebras? Like, so I'm thinking here we have like vector fields, some polynomial algebraic version of vector fields, and if we consider smooth vector fields, of course, there's a relation with the diffeomorphism group. Is there anything like this here?
Sophus Lee started with the groups, right? That was his motivation. Algebras came later. I'm not sure that there is a modern study of the corresponding groups.
Because my other question is going to be if these representations could be integrated to these groups.
See, integrating representations, because we have infinite dimensional representations.
Right.
So integrating them to the group, even if there is a group, it's a highly non-trivial question. And in general, you cannot.
Right.
As a partial answer to that, I would say the group of aberrations in optics, in two-dimensional or n-dimensional optics, realizes some of these constructions. Of course, I know very simpler cases, but you can associate some of these, call them lower dimensional polynomial algebras, with spherical aberration, comma, stigmatism, curvature of field, and so on and so on. Now, people don't use that classification, but you can still do it.
Yeah, so partially yes. Which ones can be integrated is not clear.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, so of course it also depends on the type of topology we're putting on the lead group. These are all countable dimensions, right?
Yes.
So that probably makes it easier for them to integrate than if these had some extra topology, but easier is relative, of course.
Yeah, but even in the highest weight models, not all can be integrated.
Right. Yeah, it's a non-trivial question for finite dimensional groups, I think.
Yeah, even for finite dimensional groups, here we have in one dimensional set.
Yes.
No, to be honest, I don't know. I have I don't see him. But some relation, but maybe tomorrow I will come in on some applications of this organization.
Any other question? I have one. How about realizations of these modules, the Cospidal or Cospidal highest weight modules, as operators acting in some space for which,
yeah,
you know,
nice,
following the...
It's a very natural question. There will be slides.
Okay.
I
didn't understand. Okay, no. But you're going to say something about that?
As I mentioned, that there is a relation to vertex theory.
Okay.
And this relation actually provides realization in three bosons or three fermions of these representations.
Wonderful. Yeah, you're going to talk about that tomorrow or
briefly,
or Friday.
I was going today.
Okay,
briefly,
no, that's fine. We can wait.
So for these cuspidal representations, each weight space is finite dimensional.
Yes.
So this reminds me, of course, of Parachandra modules or admissible modules for finite dimensional simple Lie algebras. And those end up being very nice and being integrable and a bunch of general theorems and the connection with the analysis and the group works out. So I'm wondering if maybe at least for some special case like that, you might be able to do something nice. Is there any connection with the behavior of admissible representations of finite dimensional?
No, because these guys are not integrable, right? Because you act infinitely. You don't have a kernel, so there's no integrability in these models for tensor fields. So you can think of them as a Harishandra modules for the Cartan-Sub algebra, for the pair algebra Cartan-Sub algebra. They are, in a sense, Harishandra modules. But that's probably all.
But that doesn't give you much.
No, it's a similar to the, say, finite dimensional simple Lie algebras, right? If you take algebra, you take Cartan-Sub algebra, you can study same weight modules. So a module that has a decomposition into the subspaces, eigen-subspaces for the Cartan. So this is an analog of Harishandra model.
Yeah, I guess with Harishandra's models, you have the maximal compact and then
exactly.
The finite dimension.
Exactly.
Yeah, so. And I guess for those, you're not guaranteed to have actually finite weight multiplicities,
no.
But finite dimension.
No, you cannot
yeah.
even guarantee that the multiplicity is a finite dimension.
Yeah.
In a simple way. So Harishandra's situation is really very specific.
Yeah.
And this is the more general.
Is there something that plays the role of the Lie algebra of the maximal compact subgroup here?
Well,
something like that.
The W0
resembles.
Remember the W0
yes.
of Schuberto fields over n minus one dimensional torus extended by a Abelian ideal, and developing algebra of that. That would be the largest we can work with, and that's fine. And it allows to. It's not, of course, compact or anything like that.
Yeah, no, of course,
but it's sort of analog.
Ah, because then you can consider modules over that and stuff.
Yes, and as I mentioned, if you take n minus two dimensional torus, then it doesn't work. When you do the whole procedure, the resulting representation would have infinite dimensional spaces, so it's too big. But if you do this sort of maximal, you get finite dimensional.
This is W0 with n minus 1.
So, yeah, it virtual fields on n minus 1 dimensional torus extended by functions times dn, the last partial. And this was surprising to me. I mean, I would not expect it to work.
Thank you. Any other question? Well, let's thank Slava, our speaker again. Thank you. we have a 25-minute break. We'll resume at 11:30.